I agreed to do this lecture, distinguished otherwise. Well, for two reasons, really. The first is to bring some of you up to date, to give a little background to where we came from, so far the energy sector is concerned. But just as important is to encourage some of you, this is supposed to be the energy campus, I'm told, to encourage some of you, both students and staff, to pursue the story, to pursue the research, and create documentation, create activity that carries the story forward. So today, I will simply give you a quick look at the history and hope that by so doing, I will encourage some of you to take that a little bit further as part of your academic activity, as part of your research, and as part of what this campus should become. If you want to live up to that name, I think you gave yourself the name, you don't have to live up to it. Nobody christened you, you have to live up to that name of the Energy Campus, which at the end of the day should be the repository of information, documentation, literature, research, all to do with the energy sector of Trinidad and Tobago. That should be our mission. That anyone who comes to Trinidad, yes, they go to see Point Lisas, yes, they go to see Atlantic LNG, but if they want to find out about the history, about what is going on in research, about what is going on in teaching, so far as the energy sector is concerned, they should come here. This should be their first stop of call. And you, your staff, students, would be able to convey to them where we came from, where we are today, and what are the prospects for the future. It's all very well going to Point Lisas, and really you don't see anything there except tall towers of steel and concrete and a few computers doing its thing. You don't even see people anymore on turning valves, or it's all been done that way. So the bottom line is the information to get a sense of the energy sector. Here should be the port of call. Here you should have documentation, exposure, posters, library, that has all the information, and there's a lot of information to be found. I'll give you some indication of what I found. So that anyone, whether it's a school child or some visiting professor or some visitor just interested in the energy sector, coming here to the energy campus of UTT should have easily accessible the story, information, and documentation. That is missing. There is scatterings of it. Ministry of Energy, for example, you go there, they do have a small library of some information. I certainly have in my own archives a substantial amount of information. I'm sure there is some also in our library. But there's no one central place where you can get not just the history, but also some of the technical aspects of the energy, elements of the energy sector that are important to us. So that's a challenge I set you as, if you want to earn that title, as the Energy Campus. It has to go beyond just having that name. Today, however, what I will simply do is introduce you to a lot of work ahead by taking a snapshot view of how the energy sector came into being in Trinidad and Tobago, and where, not even where it is today, I think that's something that you should be pursuing, and as important as where it should be heading. So my effort today is really more historical, taking us up to a point. And that's important because it's not fully recognized that if you looked at Trinidad, if somebody, a stranger, were to look at Trinidad and look at our statistics, a real mystery question that we ask, how did we get where we are today? Because if you look at the things that we're supposed to be doing, namely the gas-intensive industries, etc., if you look at our reserve picture, really you'd be mystified. Because from the context of the world, we are relatively not a big player, so far as reserves are concerned. I had a quick look at, for example, gas reserves. That's the big deal. How much gas do we have? Well, we run number 36 in the world, which is bad enough. But when you look at the figures, it's kind of a little bit mysterious how we are where we are. You go to Iran, and this is a figure that you can find from any literature. And if you look at their reserves of natural gas, they have 340 trillion cubic feet of natural gas in Iran. Qatar has 250 million. The United States, 87 million. Can you guess how much Trinidad has? 3.6. 3.6 million. We are number 36 in the world. Oil is even worse. Venezuela, who incidentally you may not know this, but our neighbor next door, now has the largest reserves of oil in the world. They've just exceeded reserves. They've just gone ahead of Saudi Arabia. They have 298 billion barrels of oil in reserve, Venezuela next door. Saudi Arabia, which used to be the leader, is now 268 billion barrels of oil in reserve. Trinidad, we have to forget billion, 728 million. We run number 44th in the world. So if you look at, anyone came in and look at this figure, they say, well, how come this little country of just over a million people with reserves of gas that is less than 1% of the total reserves of gas in the world, with reserve of oil that is even less, how come this country now is recognized as the leading, as a leader in the gas-intensive industries? What are the gas-intensive industries right next door? Methanol. We're the leading exporter of methanol in the world. Not 36 or 44, number one. Ammonia. We're number two. LNG, we're number six. So that story, how did this happen? How did this come about? Minimum reserves, very little people, very little land, and yet we now are recognized as a leader in the world, not just in the region, in the world, as a leader in the gas-intensive industries. LNG, big business, we're number six. And if you look at our reserves, you really wonder how all of this has come about. So it's a story that has to be looked at, and it's a story that began not so long ago, and the development has been very, very rapid. And I give you these facts and figures really to make two points. What a small country can do with limited reserves, which we do, we have limited reserves, just to compare ourselves with our neighbor next door, Venezuela, and I'm not being criticizing Venezuela. As I explained to you, they have the largest reserves of oil in the world today. They export, on an average, every day, 2 million barrels of oil every day is exported from Venezuela. We have trouble producing 80,000. They export 2 million. They can do much more if they had a more efficient plant, but 2 million is average. They hardly use any of their gas. You look at Venezuela and you look at across the ocean, Nigeria, they flare and burn as much gas as we use. So that is saying something. You can give your own interpretation of this, that Trinidad has found itself in a very fortunate position of making use of very limited reserves of its natural resources asset to bring us where we are today. And that is a story that should be told, and a story that should reside in this energy campus. That's not my role today. Today I want to take us back to how some of this began. And the way I'll do it is really define or identify what I call 10 defining moments. I'll be very specific what these defining moments are, and then I'll invite you, not today, but in your academic activities, either through libraries or internet, to explore what these meant. I'll give you some direction of the impact these things have, but these things are documented. And the point I'm making is some of that documentation should reside here. And you may have the responsibility of finding out where it is. And nowadays that's so easy with the internet and all of these other linkages you can have with libraries, etc. Finding out where these things are and ensuring that we build up here in this particular campus a repository of that kind of information. We can go back as far as you wish, but when I first started looking at this, actually I was spending a sabbatical at Cambridge University, where they have this fantastic library of everything ever published. Both these universities, both Oxford and Cambridge, have, by law, really an amazing concession. Anything that's published in the United Kingdom, copies have to go to them, regardless. So there's nothing you can't find. Anything that's published finds its way into their library. And if you go through the library, you'd find a lot of things about us, Trinidad, about the energy sector. But one of the interesting documents there goes back to 1595, when Sir Walter Raleigh visited Trinidad, not because he liked us, but his boats were leaking, and he wanted to patch the boats. So somehow or the other, he got wind of our pitch leak, and he was able to use the pitch leak, the asphalt. I don't think he paid anything for it, he just dug it out and fixed his boat. But he did write about it, and I quote from his narration, which goes back to 1595, when he wrote as such. So Walter Raleigh visited, this is his visit to the pitch leak. And these are his words. There is that abundance of stone pitch, the word he used, that all the ships of the world may be. And he goes on. And we made trial of it in trimming our ships in the most excellent, good, and melted not with the sun as the pitch of Norway. You know, he suddenly discovered that we had a pitch that was ideal for fixing his ships. And he compared it with the pitch he had found in Norway and was really singing the praises of the Trinidad pitch. To the extent that he came back second time, I guess, to get more pitch and probably sell it. And that was in 1617, some 20 years after. He tried to make a further visit, but he didn't quite make it because I think his head was taken off by Queen Elizabeth before that last trip. But he did have in his records this story of the Trinidad-Tobago pitch. And this is 1595. After that, there was very little about the development of our hydrocarbon resources. And very quickly, I will run through some years and names. You can chase these down yourself. 1856. One Lord Cochrane was granted concession for working the pitch leak. 1859, important date for us in Trinidad, not for us, but for the world. The first well seeking oil was drilled in Pennsylvania, United States. That is in 1859. There was a debate whether we did it before or after. But the bottom line, around the same time, the pioneers of the oil industry in Trinidad and Tobago actually began looking and drilling for oil. So over the period 1866, 1869, there are some names that you can look. Not overly well documented, but it is documented. Names like Darwent, Rust, Leelam. Over that period, these were the first pioneers who started looking for and finding oil in Trinidad and Tobago. But the first commercial production, if you use that word, was in 1907. And some of you may recall that in 2008, we celebrated 100 years of commercial oil production in Trinidad. So we've been in the business for a relatively long time. And in 1908, as I said, the first set of oil volumes were found, and in 1910, the first cargo of oil was exported. So our history of commercial production of oil, not gas, oil, began in that period, as I said, in the early 1910 onwards. Now, it came at a time when we were still very much a colony. And Britain, our colonial master, quickly recognized that this was one of their colonies, namely Trinidad and Tobago, had certain rich natural resources, and of course, began to claim it. It was theirs, we were part of a colony. So you even hear locally in the local newspaper that I quote from a local newspaper, the Gazette, goes back in that period of time, making the point that Brighton, not the Brighton of England, but our Brighton of La Brea, could become one of the fuel depots of the empire. In those days, we had the British Empire. And what sparked that off was that in 1910, the then Lord of Admiralty, Winston Churchill, Sir Winston Churchill, took a decision that the Royal Navy would depend on, would convert its use of fuel from coal to drive its ships to oil. And where would the oil come from? The only source at the time was Trinidad and Tobago. So here we have a situation where our mother country, so-called, was very dependent on the oil being produced in Trinidad as early as 1910. And that whole business of making the Royal Navy more efficient began on the basis of oil from Trinidad. To give you a sense of this, Randolph Rust, who was one of the key pioneers in the early years, in an address at what is now called, I think it's now called our National Museum. It used to be called the Victoria Institute, you know, right next to Napa, that building. It's now a museum. I quote from his speech. It has also been manifest that Great Britain, before adopting oil as fuel for her navy, must make sure of a source of oil which the outbreak of war will not cut off. And therefore, it is important that that source of oil should, if possible, be found on British territory. What is the British territory? At that time, we were British territory. In the light of my discoveries, I feel that Trinidad, and the compliment here, England's most valuable possession in the West Indies, being as it is one of the keys to the Panama Canal, now rapidly approaching completion, might itself one day be one of the chief sources of supply of oil fuel, and thanks to her unique position, might become one of our most important naval bases. So very early in the game, that was our position. We were identified very, very early as a source of this natural resource, which at the time was oil. That story goes on. I'm not going to bore you. What I now try to do is identify some of the, I use the word defining moments that provides a story. But before doing that, in still under having the status of a colony, in around early 1937, 1940, we as a country, people of this country, for the first time perhaps, began to realize that these reserves were ours, but we really didn't have its use, neither revenue nor its use. And of course, a famous name surfaced in 1937, Tubal Uriah Buzz Butler, who was one of the first, let's use the word agitators in the best sense of that word. He was Grenadian by birth, Trinidadian by adoption, and founder of what eventually is the OWU, began to make noises about the use of these reserves. Of course, he was put into jail for his efforts. That was one way of dealing with it. But later on in 1926, another name that, and this is what the point I'm making, there's history there, there are names there that we hope are not lost. And this is where the Energy Campus has a role to play, to bring to the attention of Trinidadians, people from the region, visitors, that some of these pioneers did make significant contribution. So in 1926, there's a Captain Cipriani. Again, it's a name that some of you may have heard. there's a, I think there's a statue somewhere in Port of Spain for him, where he decided that the government should seek substantial additional revenue from oil production. And I quote from one of his statements, "Whereas the finances of the government are in present in such a state as to preclude the government from undertaking certain works and or scheme of paramount importance to the inhabitants of the colony," we're still a colony, "be it resolved," this is a resolution he took to the parliament, "that the government be pleased to take immediate steps to introduce a bill for imposition of an export tax on crude and fuel oil." The first real attempt to say to the world, yes, this reserves are ours. If you want it, you have to pay for it, and there'll be a tax for all that we export. Of course, all this could take the form in the form of a recommendation, which was dismissed by the British government. Instead, they propose a cent per barrel exported and 1 cent for every foot drilled. So that places Trinidad in a particular context of not dollars anymore, but cents. At that time, we were the largest producer of oil in the entire so-called British Empire. And here we were with minimum revenue being generated. So the story goes on, that period of time. I won't bore you with too much of that. What I need to do now is to bring a little bit more up to date. Britain saw us as a very important source of fuel and of energy. And they were so concerned, even when you had, bringing you up to date, we had a refinery here, which is now Petrotin. But again, some of you may not know that. Originally, that was a refinery called Trinidad Leasehold Limited, TLL, which was owned by the British. And then to their consternation, Texaco, a large US company, bought out TLL. And it became international news because Sir Harold Macmillan, who eventually became Prime Minister of Great Britain, but at then was Chancellor of the Exchequer, had this to say. I felt he's because it was reported that TLL, Trinidad Leasehold Limited, which was owned by Britain, was moving into the hands of Texaco, which is a US-based company. We had nothing to say with it. The government had no role in this. This was being done strictly one company and another. Notwithstanding that, we said nothing, but the British government said something. And he's saying, I feel a sense of regret, even dismay, of the thought that an important asset of this kind, which is was then TLL, hitherto owned and manned by British interests, should pass out of our immediate control. We have no say in this. Here is Britain regretting that an American company had bought a local asset. That was the mood of that period of time. So for those of you who want to look at this in greater detail, there are two things. You should look at the pre-independence period, some of which I've given you. Look at the period 1957 to 1962, 5 years. We were now sensing that we'd be independent. 1957, we had a chief minister, we had some level of independence. And of course, 1962 became fully independent. So that's an interesting period of what took place in that period. Then we have the post-independence period, 1962 to 1974. And then I would call it the natural gas period, which really was triggered in 1974 and has brought us up to today. Those are the kind of periods that one should look at and try and look at that story from that perspective. What happened in those periods and what not to bring us where we are today. So at this stage, I will not be much longer. Because my effort today is not really to give you facts and figures, and the best of my knowledge, you're not going to have an examination on what I said, but really to prompt you to look in deeper into some of the things that I have said and look at the story, the facts, the figures about our energy sector, with the objective of really earning the title that this should be the energy campus of UTT. If it is, everything about energy in our country should reside here. So, all I'll now do, and I'll make this available so that some of you who are interested in it can pursue the details. There are 10 what I call, I have listed as 10 defining moments, 10 points in time from 1963. The history is there, but from 1963, bear in mind we became independent in 1962. So from 1963, we were in charge of our own affairs. So from 1963 onwards is when Trinidad and Tobago as a country took charge of its energy sector. And what I have done, I've identified 10 what I call defining moments in that period. Number one, 63-64, the Eric Williams government set up something called the Mostofi Commission. That commission was set up to see, to look at, review, and identify a path forward for the development of the energy sector in Trinidad and Tobago. A very famous commission, a big report, and I invite you to find it. It's available, I'm sure it's available on the internet. That took place in 1963-64. Then, in 1969, BP, at the time, had some assets in the Palo Seco area, and they moved out, and those assets, which were both, had a very small refinery, but they had also had oil production. That was offered to the government and was taken over, if that's the correct word, but sold to the government of Trinidad and Tobago. 1971, very, very significant year for us. Massive natural gas reserves were discovered offshore. Up until that point, we did have some limited reserves onshore in the Pinal area, which was being used to generate electricity, both in Pinal and in Port of Spain. In fact, there's a pipeline running all the way from Pinal to Port of Spain. Next defining moment, number four, Trinidad and Tobago National Petroleum Company, which we now know as NP, was established by an Act of Parliament and had the exclusive right at the time for the marketing of all our energy products, namely transportation fuel. Number five, Shell Trinidad, a company that I worked for some period of time, previously known as UBOT, United British Oil Fields of Trinidad and Tobago, which is fully owned by Shell. That, of course, was sold or taken over. I think sold is the correct word. They were no longer interested. Our onshore oil was drying up. Shell had no longer any interest in this, and therefore they offered it for sale to the government, and thus became Trintoc, 1974. in 1975, very, very important year, the National Gas Company was formed. Formed on the basis, and it's an interesting story, by that point in time, it was then Amoco, now BP, had discovered substantial oil off the East Coast. But to produce the oil in those days, a lot of gas came up with the oil, what we call associated gas. And at that time, gas had practically no value. What do you do with it? And they were burning it. They were flaring it, which still happens in the world. Venezuela next door burn every night as much gas, or every day as much gas as we use. Nigeria is even worse. I mean, if you look at a map of the world in the night, you'll find Nigeria shining bright, not because of electricity. In fact, they're very only 20% of their needs of electricity are being met, but there's a nice flare of gas being burnt. So here we are in 74, 75, when the government of the day said to then Amoco, now BP, you cannot flare gas. That was a difficult situation for them. They wanted the oil, but to get the oil, the gas came up, and the gas had nowhere to go. So they took a very simple solution. They then said to the government, we don't know what to do with it. You tell us we can't flare it, so you take it for zero cost. And that's how NGC was born. NGC was set up to capture this gas at no cost, pipe it, compress it, and pipe it ashore. And that goes back to 1975. So the NGC was formed almost as an emergency measure to take charge of this gas that was offered free of charge to avoid the company's flaring or Amoco flaring it. Of course, since then, several things have happened. Much more gas was discovered in Trinidad, but more important, gas now has a value, a significant value from then on. So the NGC grew almost, I would say by accident, but by force, but they suddenly now have become a big player in the gas. As some of you may or may not know, we now consume 4 billion cubic feet of gas a day, which amounts to 1.5 trillion cubic feet of gas a year. Half of that, a little bit more than half, goes to LNG. But the rest of it goes to the NGC to fuel all the plants you see at Point Lisas, which at the latest count was, Mr. Motilal can help me here, but I think it's 7 methanol plants and 9 ammonia plants, plus power, plus the steel complex. So we are big in the gas business. And as I said, NGC grew on the basis of almost a contingency. The company says, well, we're not going to flare it, you take it. And NGC then had to go and build a pipeline. Well, NGC was formed then for that specific purpose, to bring that gas onshore. At the time, we had no idea what it's going to be used for, but as you know, that's another story that you should develop. That whole history, 1974 onwards, how the gas intensive industries began. Of course, in 1976, as part of that, there's a power plant, and then subsequently, this establishment of ISCOT. Then a joint venture with W.R. Grace, which is now called Tringen. Then there was Fertrin, and then, we now have, as it were, as I said before, 9 ammonia-producing plants, and I think 7 methanol plants. So the story has to be written. I would not take any more of your time trying to elaborate on that. It would be a very interesting exercise for this campus to undertake either individually as part of your research, part of your project, either collectively, groups, to take the story from here. It's a story that should be documented, both for yourselves, your children, your grandchildren, and it's really, as I started telling you very, very early, it is a remarkable story. If you look, as I gave you, started telling you earlier, if you look at what were reserves, less than 1% of gas reserves in the world, and yet, in a relatively short period of time, we have used that to become a leading producer of methanol, a leading producer of ammonia, way ahead of countries that have, for example, our neighbor next door. I gave you the figure. Tremendous amount of gas, Venezuela. They've been trying for 40 years to do an LNG plant. It still hasn't happened. Discussions are now undergoing. Maybe the simplest thing for them is to bring the gas to Trinidad and we'll process it for them. That is ongoing, very serious discussion, because that makes sense, because they've been trying to do this for years, they've got nowhere. So the point I'm making there, we have a story there. We have to look at the individuals, the system of government we have here, the leadership, how we set about our business. I keep using the word the BPs, and people say BP, that's, and I said no, that's brain power. When I use the word BP, I mean brain power. Look at how we've been able to use our brain power in an environment that is stable, etc., to achieve what we have with very, very limited resources. That's my story. Thank you very much.